Can we film inside?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you.
Watch your head and your step.
All right.
Sat down with Scuba Tank in Shark's Cove. and everybody's in the shark's boat on the North Shore. And he painted the whole cove looking in, not at sea. He sat on the bottom with scuba tanks.
Wow.
But yeah, he did all these from memory. Actually, no, they're videotaping while they're down there, too. So he does have that also. It records voice, video, the entire time they're down there. And you may not have saw it, but in the rock lab on this side, we actually, there's an actual hole in the bottom of the ship. It's called a boom pole. And we lower a tracking tower down that has instruments on it, so we have voice. That's how we track the subs and communicate with them. There's voice communication also, so we can talk to them. And that's how they navigate on the bottom. Because we can tell them where they are, which direction they need to go, how far.
What about the conditions in these cells? Cold, hot?
Cold.
Really cold.
If you're 300 feet or higher, it's extremely hot. Once you get past 300 feet, it goes from comfortable to freezing. So typically, and most of the dives are deep. 300 meters, 500 meters, 600 meters. And so they'll bring sweatpants, extra socks, beanies, jackets. Yeah, they take all that with them.
And how long do they usually stay in that?
Typically 8 hours. We typically launch around 8 a.m. and then recover around 5 in the evening, 4:30, 5 in the evening. The subs have the capacity to stay under for 3 days. Typically 8 hours. There's no bathroom.
You ever lose any?
You know, I worked with them from 1990 up until about 2002, and we never lost one. Yes.
For an 8 hour shift, how much decompression would they have to go through?
It's pressurized, so...
Oh, it's pressurized.
It's pressurized, okay. so none at all.
Okay.
So you can just go down and come right up again.
Yes. They carry... He drew them on there. There's tubes. I don't see them. He didn't draw them on here. But there's tubes that they load up with. It's called shot. And basically, you know how they make...
gallon?
Yes. But your washers, where they punch the hole out of a washer, they get all that and they'll load that into the barrel. They weigh the cyanides that are going, they load those things up, and when they're ready to come up, they drop that weight, and then that gives them the buoyancy to come back up. They also have a 500-pound emergency lead weight underneath in case that doesn't work, that they can let go. Yeah, it's a dangerous operation. There's a lot of hazards, but fortunately Terry Kirby's a very capable person, and whoever he's trained has done a good job also. No. But now we have an ROV. We're shifting over to an ROV, and the next trip the ship's going on is a 30-day ROV trip. And that has the capability of going to 6,000 meters, and it has two mechanical arms and video. But they just operate it from the ship instead of being inside. Now, you have advantages to the subs because the subs can go anywhere they want. They can drive around, go here, there, everywhere, whereas the ROV is tethered to the ship. And it can't really go a lot of places that the subs can go. And any other questions? This area is like our conference room, but at sea, the scientists typically congregate here. Work on their computers and work on their papers or schoolwork. So generally they take this area over once we're out at sea.
Are there any YouTube videos posted or something that they've been able to
video? You know,
video?
What I can suggest, you guys can Google the Falkor, F-A-L-K-O-R. They probably have some stuff online. And you could try and Google Pearl, H-U-R-L, and there may be some stuff online for that. But the Falkor was just here. Now they're making They're called sea gliders, and they're shaped like a torpedo. And they can program them, and they launch them, and they can stay up to a month on station, and they drive around, and they collect, you know, whatever they collect. And a lot of times they'll come up and surface, broadcast all that out, all that information, bring in new where they want it to go next, and back down it goes. But they also have wave gliders, which is like a surfboard now. And it's got these fins that hang underneath, and as the wave pushes it up, the fins bend, and when it goes back down, they push. And it propels these things through the water. So the Falkor was just did 2 15-day trips with UH scientists, the sea glider and wave glider.
Those are unmanned vehicles, right?
Those are unmanned vehicles, yes. But that's the power of GPS now, and satellites, and so that scientists can gather information without even having to go to sea. It's really nice technology. We're really happy with it.
Hmm. How many scientists are working with this program?
Well, the HOT program has about 8, and now there's a new one. This acronym is SCOPE. Don't ask me what it stands for. But that's money that Dave Carls brought in, and that group probably has about 12. And they have some of them are in our building back there where you guys were, and they have their laboratories there.
What other scientific organizations please do ship?
Oh, yes. Well, basically, have you heard of UNOLS? The University National Oceanographic Laboratory System, UNOLS. And that's Scripps, Woods Hole, University of Oregon, University of Hawaii, and they're all funded through NSF, or the National Science Foundation. And that's who funds all the scientists. The scientists send in ship time requests. They review them. Okay, we'll fund you, not you, you, not you. And until they use all their funds up. Congress appropriates money each year. You know how much they have to give out. We're currently, the past 2 days, we've been in negotiations for our 2019 schedule. For Kiel Moana. So it's a fairly involved process, picking the scientists, getting them all straight on all the ships. And our ship was built by ONR, Ocean Naval Research, so it's government owned. NSF just built the Sally Ride and the Neil Armstrong, which are two new research ships. And they're building 3 more right now. And there's different classes. There's global, intermediate, and then the smaller ships. They're starting to get smaller because these ships are so expensive to operate.
Yeah.
They found that the larger ships just cost too much. So they're starting to get smaller again.
But it's great that they're spending money on water, where they've always spent going to the moon and everybody.
Money that they've appropriated for.
Yes. It's your U.S. tax dollars at work.
Yeah.
They're all funding this type of. But there's private organizations also that are doing it also. That's like the Falkor. It's owned by the Wendy and Eric Schmidt Foundation. He was the CEO of Google. They bought a German fisheries boat, turned it into a research ship, and they take scientists out for free. They don't charge them. And they pick people that didn't get funded.
Mm. Those staggering operating costs that you said, the $28,000 for this vessel and $50,000 for the other, besides personnel and fuel costs, what percentage would be approximately what would go for like scientific equipment and stuff that would be part of that?
Well,
I don't know. Sorry if
the scientists bring their own, but we supply like the winches, the cranes. And those types of things, all that money covers the ship costs, the fuel, the crew, the food, insurance, shipyard costs, and that's basically how they generate the day rate.
Thank you.
So the scientific work is entirely separate from the cost.
Pardon?
The scientific budget is entirely separate.
Yes, they have to pay for flying their team here, or wherever they're going, shipping their gear. All of that. it's a lot of money, it's a lot of work. Yeah, there's a lot of rules and regulations now, it's very difficult. And actually, we're running into problems now where New Zealand is really coming down on, you know, how you clean your hull, all types of environmental, and here in Honolulu Harbor, we can't clean the hulls anymore. Yeah, it's a mess. I still haven't figured out how we're gonna get around that. But yeah, it's very difficult. Ballast water, ballast water regulations. Now we have to have systems. You can't, before we do what's called a ballast water transfer. Once you're out 200 nautical miles, you flush all your tanks with open seawater before you were fine. Now you have to have treatment systems. There's these companies that are building, like they use ultraviolet light to kill all the organisms, or there's various ways that it's done, and it's very expensive.
That's a paradox, but you have to do that, and yet only the other countries are dumping
But they have to comply with the ballast water.
Well, and all that other stuff that's ending up in the gyre.
Yeah.
You know,
here's something here in the state of Hawaii that drives me crazy. Here in Honolulu Harbor, the EPA came and did an inspection, fined them a couple million dollars because they weren't keeping their storm drains clean and this, that, and the other thing. They created this decree. Now I can't, if I get a piece of dust going in the water here, they freak out. But you can go out on Nimitz Highway and all the storm drains are clogged, full of trash. And
coming from all the homeless people who are camped along the side.
That problem too. Well, that's what I said, when they were all underneath the freeway over there in that area, right by over estuary, all that going, you know, and I mentioned that to them, and they just like, I can't hear you. You know, so even here in Hawaii, that I am so tightly regulated because I'm on the harbor, but everywhere else it's open season. Yeah, it's crazy.
How often is a ship like this dry dock?
It's 3 times in 5 years. So at the beginning of 5 years starts one cycle, around 2.5 years is another cycle, and then at the end of 5 years is a...
You could do that here at Morisco's or something, but where do they do that?
Morisco is available, although we don't like them. Typically we go all the way to the West Coast.
Oh.
It's cheaper to drive the ship all the way there, get the work done, and drive all the way back, than go to Morisco. Shipyards are like pirates. Terrible. I hate shipyards. You're a captain, yep.
Yeah.
And they charge you for every little thing. Shipyards are a battle. We're always drained whenever we get done with one.
When and if the Chinese buy this, do these prints go with them?
Probably not. That's what we're trying to decide, is what's going and what's not, depending on who gets the boat.
You should
publish. Probably not these. No, these are original.
These should be published.
Terry,
you know, printed. And
Terry does. I have separate photos or reprints from him. If you go to Hurl, you probably see Terry Kirby's name. If you want some, you can ask him.
Oh.
He's very generous. We're gonna go up forward, and I'll show you the galley area real quick. Then we're gonna go upstairs,
yeah,
and we'll look at a couple of the staterooms. And then from there, we'll go up to the bridge.
Okay?